Welcome back to our program, guys, and we are almost at the halfway point of the show, which is leading us into our first discussion. However, before we get into it, I'd like to ask Karina, where do you usually look for recommendations for places if you want to?
I feel like we start every talk show, you and I, with you asking me a question. Let me ask you a question for once.
Yeah. Okay. Well, go ahead. Shoot.
Where do you look for references?
I usually ask you. No, I don't know. Honestly, there's just so much information out there. And the tendency is to, if you don't know, for example, a place to eat, you'll be like, hey, let me just Google and read the Google reviews.
Okay, so you go to Google, I go to Instagram.
But, okay. But also, I don't trust it because everyone has differing opinions.
That's true.
Right? And now, these days, you can easily find references about the latest trends or anything that's actually related to Jakarta, such as restaurants, lifestyle, fashion, even culture, in online articles. However, many of them lack the information regarding location, prices, and reviews.
Exactly, Paul, which is actually the key information that we're always looking for, right? Now, to find the solution to that, a local man established an online publishing platform that can help Jakartans and visitors, of course, find the latest trends right here in the capital city through in-depth reviews and different perspectives.
Is that what we're called on? Jakartans? I wasn't aware of that. Jakartans.
I like that.
Well, yeah, me too. Anyway, without further ado, let's welcome Manual Jakarta founder and director Hadi Ismanto to find out more about his platform and the latest trends, of course. Hadi, welcome to the studio.
Good morning.
Thanks, Paul.
So, hi, Karina.
Hi.
Fancy seeing you here.
Yeah, weird. Okay, we should explain. We knew each other outside of the program, and we've never seen each other this early in the
this
morning.
Exactly.
Well, not in this context.
Not in this context.
Exactly.
Anyway, yeah. So, start off by telling us about Manual Jakarta and how you got started with it.
Yeah. I started Manual in late 2013. Mm-hmm. Once I came back from Melbourne upon my graduation. With this idea that, of course, we had a vision within the company that we want to challenge the standard of media in Indonesia, right? The way it's being produced, the way it's being distributed, the way it's even consumed by our audience. And Manuals is definitely our first pilot project because it was the perfect timing, right? We lived in an era where bloggers still reign as king. You know, in 2013, so you have fashion bloggers, you have food bloggers around, but there was this missing gap between a kind of media that is still upholding a lot of journalistic integrity and values.
There was a shift at the time, if I'm not mistaken,
right? It was a shift,
2010, between like...
Exactly, because social media was new.
Very
much. If you remember 2012, 2013, Instagram was still a baby.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah, so there wasn't this kind of platform that upholds that values while being relevant at the same time. So we and having that privilege coming from Melbourne, right? I mean, I got to see the specialty coffee scenes, the art scenes, the design scenes, and to me, I thought that hey, you know, this is what quality is, and this is what quality means, and you know, by lo and behold, I think Jakarta is heading towards that way. And I think in 2014, it was the year where all the big specialty coffee brands are starting to come in. So you have 115, you have Tanamera,
St. Ali, right?
Common Grounds. Yeah, yeah. It's all set up in the same year.
Correct.
Right. And look at where they are right now, right? So it was the perfect timing.
No, for sure. I think dating back to 2013, well, a decade ago, when I was still in high school, I remember...
You have to emphasize on that. Why do you have to emphasize on that?
Because I remember I first made Instagram in 2013 when I was in high school, and it was so new that there weren't anything. Like, people were just posting the randomest things. Like, you know how it's so much more...
I posted a table, I think, my first post.
Like, ooh, now it's like super curated, where back then it's literally like Paul.
There was no ads.
Exactly. The first thing you see, I'm gonna post this. So, you know, you started back in 2013 where you said we're Instagram, just social media. Still a baby.
Yeah.
And you sort of built that bridge between, like, I'd say print media and digital media, right? But obviously, and coming back from Melbourne, that obviously inspired you to create this. But what drove you, what gave you sort of the encouragement to go, you know what, I see that there's a future and there's potential for this going big in Jakarta, in Indonesia. I want to start this.
Honestly, I think most of it was gut feelings.
Okay.
You know what I mean? It's like, I didn't have, I mean, I came from Pekanbaru, right? A small city outside Jakarta in Riau. And I didn't have the privilege or knowledge to do all these things like market insights, customer insights. So what I did was that I believed looking at the problem that me and my friends faced during right. that time. Where you said that exactly, right? I mean, when we wanted to look for the most romantic coffee shop in Kemang, for example, like all these Google reviews, all this internet mm-hmm. contents being presented to us are not the type of romantic that we define.
Right.
You know, the definition of romantic is just different. Mm-hmm. Just because you're a rooftop bar doesn't mean you're a romantic bar. For sure, right? You've been there. So I feel like there needs to be a platform that fulfills this missing gap of quality places, quality founders, quality baristas that do not get to see the light of day, you know, just because they are not sexy enough, you know, they are not loaded enough to spend all that money to be featured on medias and stuff like that during those days. So we felt like, let's just do this and see where it takes us for the next 2 or 3 years. And apparently we are very thankful because a lot of people appreciated us on that. And we gained a lot of communities based on that, how useful it is for them.
Okay, yeah, I want to talk more about that because the person who first put me on, before we knew each other, was my wife, put me onto Emmanuel Jakarta. And once I was on it, I would trust Emmanuel Jakarta for certain reviews or for a certain kind of like, I need to get a take on this place before I go there, or if I should bring my friends there, if this is the right place to be. Now, obviously, that takes a lot of years of building your own reputation and how you curate these places and how you choose. So can you tell us a little bit about the process behind how it is that you're able to maintain this? You use the word quality a lot.
Yeah.
How do you maintain that quality? Is it something that you curate yourself? How is it that you form your team to have kind of like a similar mindset, to be kind of like-minded in a way you select places and you review places so that us, the reader, is able to already know what we're getting into? Yeah. Because it is one of my trusted sources when it comes to places.
Thank you.
So I'd like to know what was the process. What is the process behind it?
Yeah, I think you say that. I mean, we did a very, and we are still doing a very strict process of curation. So first and foremost, we never take any sort of financial benefits, any money. We don't accept endorsement. We don't accept paid review.
Really?
Yeah, even until today.
It's interesting to point that out, by the way, because a lot of places, and I do this with gadget reviews as well.
Yeah.
I read it, but I go scroll to the end real quick because if this person is getting paid for this review, then I already have to keep that in mind when I'm reading the review.
Exactly.
So go on, that's actually interesting.
Exactly, yeah. Because we felt that, I mean, coming from a media background and as a media student, I fully understand how a media can sustain itself as a business, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of revenue streams other than just advertisements, of course. And I think to be a bit idealistic in a world and in an era where, you know, the media in Indonesia, especially in 2013, was so corrupted, you know, was so personal gain kind of centric.
Yeah.
We decided, okay, let's be a bit crazy and close this revenue stream of paid endorsement and advertisements. That's why in our curation, especially in the early years of Manuel, what we did is that me and our editor-in-chief and right now my business partner as well, Julius Kensan, we scoured Jakarta on our own. You know, we drove, we see these coffee shops. This seems interesting. Let's try their products. Let's talk to the baristas. Let's talk to the owners. And we did it really organically, especially the first 3 years. Of course, afterwards, as the business grew, I started to onboard other different positions such as business development, manager, many times driver, you know, but Julius has onboarded that, I would say, vision and make it his own and expanded it. And something that I'm super grateful is that I think one thing that he, one term that he coined, and I feel like this is Manuel Jakarta unofficial tagline, is the fact that through Manuel we help you to not only discover but rediscover the city. You know what I
like
mean?
That.
Yeah, I mean that's kudos to Julius. Because I was talking to Karina right behind the scene. I mean we have friends who lived in Jakarta for 20 years, 30 years, probably lives in Pik, probably lives in Tomang, but never once in their lifetime steps foot in Kemang.
Right.
You know that happens in Jakarta and we feel like being in this kind of city, I mean, it takes so much effort to actually stop and put some sort of a highlight and attention to all these things that are going through around us, right?
Yeah. By the way, that's also an interesting point for you to mention because I found that Jakarta, like 10 years ago, used to be much more segmented. Like if you're in the north, you would just play and hang out in the north.
Yeah.
And if you're in the south, it's still very much like that. However, we explore a lot more now.
Yeah.
And I think because of platforms like Manual, you know more about places
and
before
like,
you visit.
And you're like, oh, there's this place worth checking out.
That's
like maybe we're in the south, but it's in the north. Like,
exactly.
I want to make this trip because...
There's toll roads everywhere.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Now, Hadi, just sort of touching base on what Paul have mentioned as well, or asked you.
Yeah.
There's some sort of exclusivity as well, right? Because, you know, you curate specifically, you pick the places, you don't take endorsements or paid advertisements for the places that you scout. Now, but that being said, do you get like approached a lot by like new places, and how do you sort of differentiate between all the places, and how do you maybe politely decline if you don't want to review a place? Has that ever happened?
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that happens a lot.
Just don't show up. Hey, come to my place. Sorry, busy.
I think having these kind of values of upholding integrity as a journalist, even, we always made it up to a point that when we got invited to events, we always made it a point that we cannot promise you a feature.
Okay.
You know, we'll.
Right.
I mean, if that's okay with you, we'll come. Of course, we'll accept your invitation, but we cannot guarantee that.
Mm.
And in occasions where we think that the places do not resonate with our segment,
right?
You know, with our audience, with what they think quality is and what they think quality is not.
Right.
We'll politely say that I'm really sorry, but you know, I don't think this fits to our segment
and
target market. And I think that's that, right?
Right.
And I think not having to accept any kind of paid endorsement and paying our own meals actually give us that privilege.
That
we don't owe people anything.
True.
You know, in that sense.
You're not leveraged obligated. To guarantee
exactly.
anything. Yeah.
So do you feel like, obviously, that comes at a cost, these idealisms, because not having that particular revenue stream that others may have.
Yeah.
Do you feel that has hindered your progress or Manuel's progress over the years, that perhaps we could have done more if we had this extra revenue stream, but nevertheless was the right choice that you made?
Yeah, of course. I mean, talking to a lot of homeless media nowadays, I mean, knowing how much money they make, like tens of billions of rupiah every single year, compared to us who does much more lesser, but with three times the effort, you know, a lot of times it takes a toll on the spirit of me, my employees and the company, of course. But I think it's my job, right, as the CEO and as the founder, to keep on reminding everyone that what we are doing right here is not, you know, it's not money. Of course, money is important. We need it to sustain the business. We need it to grow. We need to help the industry as well. But it's not the most important thing. So what we did is that I've been settled with how should I grow Manuel in the first place. I know what kind of brand Manuel is and what kind of brand Manuel is not. And the price that we pay is, of course, the timing. Right? We cannot grow as fast as other medias. But at least the benefits we got out of this compromise is the fact that we managed to gain community who's very loyal, who is very trusting to what we say and what we do, and something that cannot be bought with money, right?
Absolutely.
I think that's something that eventually we will try to commercialize, of course, ethically as well. But pandemic happens. That's why a lot of plans got postponed for the past 3 years. But we are working a lot of our products moving forward.
Yeah, you mentioned a couple of times community. So let's talk about that for a minute. Yeah. I'm sure our viewers who are not familiar would like to know. So who exactly is your segment? Who exactly is your market?
Easy, Paul, Karina. These people are our segment.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think our segment a group of people who not only wants to go to a place because it's Instagrammable, or whether it's because, oh, it's the hype thing to do, but it's because those places, those founders, those brands have stories to tell, right? They have a dedication to quality. They have a commitment to do their best, whether it's a coffee shop, whether it's bars at nights, whether it's a fashion brand, whether it's a art gallery, for example. I mean, all these have stories that are deservingly to be heard. Right, and our segment are the people that want to know that story beyond just nice shots on Instagram.
That's true.
Yeah,
there's tons of nice looking places
exactly.
out there, right?
Exactly. And I think a lot of other medias have done that yeah. to cover yes. those pieces of like, why do we have to do the same thing?
I think that's also what makes like cafes or places sustainable, right? Yeah. I mean, if you're only just nice for Instagram,
another flash in the pan.
Yeah, you go yeah. there once, you have your shot, and that's kind of about it.
Yep.
But obviously, people would like to know more about the quality of the products, yeah. food maybe.
Exactly.
It's an art gallery.
Who the founder is.
Exactly. Yeah.
What's the founder's background and sure. all these things. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I guess being organic, I guess, is yeah. key for me, because I find that in order for me to find something, I need authenticity and the way that it's built is organic. That's yeah. what gives Manual legitimacy.
Mm-hmm.
What is your strategy to stay relevant and to maintain that legitimacy that your loyal community is already kind of locked in for? How do you plan to maintain that?
I go out every night.
I know, I can imagine, right? You must have been to so many places. Like,
yeah. Yeah,
what's that like? I mean,
it got really tiring, but I think it always got exciting, right? Because I feel like even Mbak Cynthia Wiryono from yes. Bright Spot also mentioned this. I think one of the easiest ways to stay relevant and to understand what's going on in your market is actually to go out.
Be out yeah. there.
Be out sure. there. And
experience it.
Experience
on your
it,
own.
The yeah. music, the drinks, and whatever's going on with the food, with the culture. I think that's what I do, right? And I've made peace with that this is my life. I gotta go out, you know, even during weekends when I don't feel like it, I gotta go out, right?
Yeah, that's where we run into
each other all the time. But at the end of the day, it's always about taking responsibility.
Yeah.
That I know we are a media company. I mean, we made ourselves to be in the beginning. So we have that responsibility to understand what the market is doing right now
yes.
yeah.
and what the market needs and what our community needs, what our brand needs as well. That's why we go out and we see if there are ways that we can serve them. Yeah, of course, we cannot do it 100% correct. We cannot do it all the time. But there are so many ways that, oh, you know, just giving a shout out in our manual weekend
yeah.
calendar, mm-hmm. that actually helps these brands. And
yeah, right.
and giving them a shout out through a feature, highlighting on what they do best,
mm-hmm.
will help them with their revenues and,
sure.
and crowds that are coming back again and again. And that those are something that we just keep on doing. And that means so much more.
Can't put a price tag on that either.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because I feel like even though as niche as it is, there's always someone looking for that.
Yeah.
You know, like
exactly.
maybe a Japanese restaurant, but yes, but like it serves a really rare dish that someone's yeah. maybe looking for here and hey, oh my gosh, Manuel highlighted that. It's just what I'm looking
yeah.
for. And I
exactly.
think it's that kind of quality that we seek as
Definitely.
Well. And before we wrap up, Hadi, how do you see Manuel striving? Like, what do you see? What's next for Manuel? And, you know, coming from, I mean, my background is also in media. As a media person to another media person, how do you see the media right here in Indonesia?
Especially in like now that like social media.
Yeah.
It's kind of like,
not just
yeah,
like, you know,
wearing thin
OG
now.
Conservative yeah. media. It's like
yeah,
the
yeah,
renowned
yeah.
media of today.
Yeah, that's a very deep topic to be talking on a morning show like this.
Save the best for last.
Save the best for last. But I would say whatever we see happening in the media scene in Indonesia, right? I mean, it's not only us, right? It's happening globally, of course, as you know, coming from a media background. So the question is, it's still within our control. It is still within our decision on how do we want this media platforms and all the varieties and all the alternatives within it, even influencers included, right, fit into the ecosystem
right.
of making Indonesia a better place. Will it be a media that's just, you know, keep on consistently serving trashy stuff, but it's good, right? It's like eating junk food.
Yep.
You know what I mean? It's like, you know, it's funny,
you
it's
miss
light.
It sometimes.
Yeah.
I feel like there's nothing wrong with junk food.
Sure.
I mean, to me, at least personally.
In moderation.
I still eat it. I
yep.
still enjoy
Same.
It. But I know that, you know, I cannot eat it every single day.
It's not sustainable.
Right? Because I believe that your output is determined by your input.
Yes.
And I feel like media,
true.
The kind
Very
of
true.
Info you content and content you consume, it will affect you.
Of course.
On
that's a good analogy.
Exactly. On the kind of creation that you do, on your work, whether you're a designer, whether you're an architect.
Yeah.
And I think that mindfulness has grown, especially for the past 5 years. And I'm happy with that. But I feel like there's still a lot of homework to be done in Indonesian media landscape.
Still room to grow, but certainly Emmanuel's always leading the way, so hopefully. Hope it continues that way.
Hopefully.
And if you're not familiar, please do familiarize yourself. Emmanuel Jakarta, just look it up on your social media platforms.
Thank you.
Hadi, thank you so much for coming by.
So
it's great having you in the studio. And nice to see you, up this early.
I know.
Yeah, on a Monday morning.
Still such a long way to go throughout the day. Again, great to have you. We do have to take another short break here on the program, but when we return, we will recap some of our earlier stories in case you're just joining us. Please do stay tuned.